Hello, everybody. There we are. Welcome to the 38th edition of Petja Kutja Eindhoven, straight from the TU terrain in Eindhoven. And we have almost empty audience today, but that's for a reason, I've been told. So we have dark days indeed in this winter time, but let's enlighten the people back home with some interesting new topics to discuss. We have a perfect starter for today. I would like to welcome Noemi Hofstede and Jim to the stage, please, for a nice musical introduction of this evening. Thank you very much.
Skin gray, the smell of lavender lingers on all clothing. Bow tie, straw hat, I sing hump the bump like the time we went to. So I might admit I don't have time to think. Every day you pass by my mind and I still cry, yeah. Every day you pass by my mind and I still cry, yeah. Like that time, like that time. My hair white, your skin gray, the smell of lavender lingers on all clothing. A bow tie, a straw hat, I sing hump the bump like that time we went to and saw Mickey Avalon on stage and I asked Dad, do you mind pink ladies in the sky? Golden delicious, you're not gold in the sky. Final nail on the coffin, Sunday morning, bad news always comes early. Stubborn like a child, I saw him losing his mind. I saw him losing his mind over money. Green, yellow, brown, purple too, and it's fair to say the AO made it foggy. Foggy blue, you told me all the time. Roller coasters were built this way to simulate life. You told me all the time, with every click you hear up, it's only time before it goes down, 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 down. It takes time, baby, it takes time. I told you all the time, roller coasters were built this way to simulate the way life's about to go down and up and down and up and down, up and down and up and down and up and down, 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 down. It takes time, maybe it takes time. Call my own, used to be my own. Backbone, 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 backbone. You broke my spine, broke my throne. There's nothing left, I should have known. that he would kiss my self-indulged wounds until the bruises black and blue. Butterflies flew, and I just don't think this suits you. Maybe not, no. And I just don't think this suits you. Maybe not, no. Hurt myself, cut up some wounds, paint myself purple, black and blue. I was on my way to hurt myself, cut up some wounds, paint myself purple, black and blue. I was on my way to, and I just don't think this suits you. Maybe not, no. And I just don't think this suits you. Maybe not, no. Every now and then I catch myself dreaming, and I'm dreaming about every shower and every gas station. And I'm dreaming you would be driving, and I'm in the passenger seat. And I'm dreaming this could be our salvation. Naked facing strangers retreat, and I'm dreaming. I'm dreaming, and I'm sneller dan de slides. Ja, dank jullie wel. Dit, ja, was het.
Thank you, thank you. But before you guys leave, can you please head back, because we're not done yet. But that was beautiful.
Thank you.
It's a really nice start for today. I'm way more relaxed than I was at the beginning. So, thank you. For the people back home, this was Noemi Hofstede. And Jim, thank you so much for coming. But, no, you can't leave yet. I'm gonna check if there are some comments from the people that are back home and watching.
Okay.
Yes, mostly compliments, actually, about Jim looks good. And also,
I agree. Jim looks really good. Well, can the people in this in the room please put their hands together for Noemi Hofstede and Jim? And now we're all of us are a little bit more warm inside, and we feel a lot better about these dark days. But we also crave physical contact. And, you know, I can't hug my mom, and I really hate it. But, you know, I just don't want to make her sick or anything. But still, there are some smart people in this world that come up with solutions to make physical contact in a way still possible. Please put your hands together for I lost track of my cards. See, I told you I was gonna mess up something. Put your hands together for Sima Ipaksian Askari.
Okay, hello everybody. So my name is Sima. I'm a PhD student at Human Technology Interaction. Like already said, my research focuses on mediated social touch. So today I'm going to tell something about a study that we've done and the insights that we've gained doing this study. So I would like to start off with the importance of social touch. So we know from background research that social touch is very important for well-being, reducing stress, anxiety, pain, as well as playing an important role in communication. Alongside this, we also know that it is important for human development. So overall, it has many benefits in general. However, there are instances where distance prevents us from having physical contact. So think when you're in a long distance relationship, your parents are in a caring home, but most relevant now because of the COVID-19 pandemic and the social distancing regulations, preventing us from having these interactions. So you see that people come up with very creative solutions. So these hugging screens to still have some form of physical interactions. Other examples are replacing shaking hands by the elbow shake or feet shakes, just as a replacement to still have some form of interactions to social touch. So looking at this period, we know that many people are suffering from touch deprivation, so just a lack of touch. Like the tweet that you can see here, someone craving for social touch, so-called touch hunger, touch starvation, especially also people who are living alone or in a caring home and who don't have access to these, to these touches. So overall, this is a bad thing. We know from background research that touch deprivation is something bad. Reduced access to touch has negative consequences, showing negative effects on behavior, but also on human development. But luckily, there are technologies that have been focused on trying to compensate for this lack of touch by using technologies, haptic technologies, to still have some form of tactile sensation, both commercially but also prototype devices. So these devices differ a little bit in their categories. So you have mediated social touch devices. These are devices that are really aimed at mimicking touch as we know it. So giving a hug, for example, to a vest. So imagine yourself wearing a vest that actually resembles the feeling of a hug sent by your mother or a friend, for example, or receiving a stroke, for example. On the other hand, there are devices that are aimed to communicate a symbolic meaning. So, for example, these bracelets that share the feeling of a vibration to indicate to someone that you're thinking of them. Or, for example, sharing your emotions through warmth to still show that you love someone. And lastly, there are devices that aim at creating awareness of the other. So, for example, sending specific information, such as heart rate, to such rings, for example. So imagine that your father and you are wearing the same ring, and it shares you the feeling, it gives you the feeling of his heart rate to vibrations. So a lot has been done on development, but also research of these devices, but we don't know enough on what people actually think of these devices. So what are their attitudes? Are they actually interested in using these type of devices? So therefore, we conducted a survey, and we did this survey during the intelligent lockdown with the aim to better understand whether actually people are interested in using such devices. And especially these times where everyone is more aware of the importance of social touch allows us to get a clearer idea whether they actually see the potential of those solutions in compensating for a lack of social touch. So I'm going to start off with sharing some of the results. So you see in the findings that are a little bit mixed. So on the one hand, there are people that are very critical on these devices. Don't thinking it can mimic touch, compensate for the lack of touch, finding it intrusive, also being quite uncomfortable with using such devices, as well as thinking that touch should not be intervened to technology. Part of this can be because touch technologies are rather new, so the novelness of these technologies might result in people being quite skeptical and also having not yet the right mindset because it's so new and so unfamiliar. So it might take some time before they actually get used to the concept. On the other hand, you also see that there is a relation between people that have a lack of touch and their interests. So people that have a higher need of social touch are much more interested in these devices compared to people who have a lower need or no need. So we see a relationship there. But on the bright side, we also see some positive effects. So people that actually do see the added value of such devices in terms of communicating affection, support to someone, and still have some form of touch in these times through technology. And when we take a close look to actually what type of devices they then find most valuable, we see that it's hug devices, but also symbolic devices. So not per se actually these devices that mimic social touch. They also saw value in devices that have more abstract meaning, for example, and also saw them as meaningful, possible because they communicate social support and comfort. So there are some take-home lessons from our studies. So one is we need to take into account the time in which we do the study. So right now, this is such a new technology, people might not have been ready yet for such devices. So this might change actually over time. It's something that is not static, these attitudes. Second lesson is these devices, the interest depends on need. So when we're going to research such devices, it's also important to take into account these needs. Not everyone has a need for social touch at the moment. So this can change their attitudes towards such technology as a whole. And lastly, symbolic devices can also be of added value. And that's why you also on the picture see that hand disappearing, because we don't need to mimic touch per se in order to have a meaningful communication. It can be also through a symbolic way rather than a mimic. So that was the end of my presentation. Yeah, almost exactly at time.
Thank you, Sima.
You're welcome.
All right, let's head to the comment section. The online comment section, that is.
Yeah, I think everyone, it was clear for everyone. There are no questions.
Well, you did a really good job. No comments. But I do have a question.
Okay.
I'm really curious about your personal motivations for this project. Are there any?
Yeah, probably. So I grew up in the Netherlands, and most of my family is actually at my home, the country where I was born, Iran. So actually, I think one of the drivers is that at one point my grandmother got very ill, and at that point, me and my dad could not visit her. So I think at that time, where someone is very ill and you want actually just to give them a hug, you realize how important that social touch is. And I think when I just saw the application, that made me realize actually that this might not only be the case for me, but also a lot of other examples. So people in a caring home that just get less touch than, for example, us. And I think those instances in combination are just, one of the drivers, I think, why I love the research so much, because I hope, I mean, I won't give them the solution, but I hope at least my work can be a building stone towards making their life a little bit easier.
Well, it's a very noble goal. Thank you so much for coming. Please put your hands together for Sima Ipakshian Askay. And our next speaker for today, as you are very familiar maybe with us, we always change topics drastically. And our next speaker for today is Emily Salvia. And Emily is a drag performer from Breda, and her goals are to pay more attention to feminism and the social status of all sexualities and diversity in sexuality. Please put your hands together for Emily Salvia.
Thank you. It's 2017, and I'm standing in the busiest shopping street of Breda City. People in the street are telling me that I'm a freak, that I don't belong in their street. Now, 3 years later, I'm still performing as a drag queen. I don't know why. I'm gonna tell you. Hoi, my name is Emily Salvia and I'm a Dutch drag performer from Breda City. And I have to stay on this carpet. It's a whole new world for me. Get it? Aladdin? I thought it was funny. Okay, maybe you're wondering how I look like as a boy. I'm gonna show you. This is not a picture from Holland's Next Top Model. This is just my profile picture on Facebook. This is me. This is Luke. And let me tell you something about Luke. Luke is a very intelligent, smart, funny boy, but very insecure. And that started in high school. As many queer people, high school was a hell. I got bullied a lot, got an eating disorder, and the only time I really felt free was in my theater class. You see a photo of me in my theater class. It was so fun. You can be anyone who you want to be. And there were like no social standards, just you and the stage. After my high school, I started social work. I work with different kind of people, elderly, mentally disabled, and I learned I want to mean something for the world. I want to make a change, a difference. I think that's something about our generation. Make the world better. Ook boomer. So after my social work, I got into the theater school in Utrecht, the HKU. And it was so fun because I got to do what I love doing the most, standing on stage, being who I want to be. But there was one class who was really special for me. It was a class where we had to walk in heels. And I never done that before. So it looked like this. I was not drunk, I was just walking in heels. But there was like a clash in my head. The masculine side of me said, "You can't like this, you are a man." And I was like, "But I love it." And I was so confused. I was like, "Huh?" That was the first time my two identities really clashed. So after 1 year of theater school, I got into art school in Breda, Sint Joost. And I studied film and photography, I'm still studying that. But in your first half year, you get all kind of classes through each other. You have to learn anything about everything. And the first assignment was make something about your favorite place. So I made a dress out of my bathroom. And I wore the dress in drag, and I stood there 10 minutes in the same pose. Yeah, people yelled at me, said I didn't belong in their street, as I said in the beginning of the presentation. But I was like, yes, my art is communicating, I'm doing something good. So I was like, okay, where can I do more drag? And the only place you can do drag in Noord-Brabant was the Miss Travestie Noord-Brabant pageant. Yeah, and I became sixth out of the six contestants. Yeah, it was a bummer. But there were special people in the audience. People of House of Tom Tom, a drag house from Nijmegen. And they said, "We want you in our family." So I was adopted to a drag family in Nijmegen. And I performed there every month. And it was so fun. I had a family of people who really understood me and were outcast by themselves. And I think that's where my activism started. You see it here? Yeah, free the nipple. Woman can show the nipples too. It's okay. This is a safe space. And I was like, yeah, this is, I can mean something to the world. People are listening to me when I'm wearing makeup and wearing a wig. This is not my real head, it's a wig. Yeah, shocker, I know. But I was like, yeah. And after a year, I took my revenge at the Miss Travestie Noord-Brabant pageant. And I won! Yeah! I'm Miss Travestie Noord-Brabant 2019. And I was like, okay, what am I going to do with this title? I have like a voice now. And I felt so special in Nijmegen with my drag family. I was like, whoa, I want to create this in Noord-Brabant. So I started my own drag house, House of Salvia. Yeah, you can tell, but I'm a mother of 12. Try that. It was so cool to educate my children and learn something about my world, about the art of being a drag performer. So, phew. And I took them to clubs, to bars, and performed with them together. every month we had our own night at the Venice Bar in Breda, and we performed there every month with another team. You see here a picture of me performing. That's what I love doing the most, at the curtain. It's like a bus ran over me, but I hope for you guys at home it looks better. And people wanted to join the house, but we were like, oh no, we have to grow as a house. So I started giving workshops with my best friend, the Salvia Project, where we educate people about drag. We learned them how to do makeup, how to perform, how to dance, how to walk in heels so they don't have to walk like this. And yeah, we created a platform, and I was like, well, I want to do more, I want more education. So I went to the library and read stories for little children of 7 years old who ask me if I'm a princess. No, I'm a queen. Yeah, being a drag queen is really something. You can mean something. People see you as a freak, but they also give you a platform. I don't think they wouldn't have given me this platform if I wasn't wearing this. But here I am, talking about my life and how things can be different and special if you believe in it and dream about it and have nice people around you. That's one of the most important parts. So now, 3 years later, I'm still performing as Emily Salvia, my drag persona, still educating the children, the people at home. Hi. And talk about my life. It's okay to not fit in. Make your own box. Be different. Dare to be you. Yeah. So when I was standing there in the busiest shopping street of Breda, I really felt like an outcast. 3 years later, I'm still performing as a drag performer. Wanna know how? I've created a family out of outcasts. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Emily.
Hello, handsome.
Well, hello to you too. So, before we continue, we have maybe some questions from the online audience.
Yeah, well, mostly proud comments to Emily. So I think everybody was blown away by your performance.
Thank you.
There was a lot of energy, a lot of good, positive energy. I can tell you're really in the right spot.
Thank you. Yeah, really I had to stand in the middle, so I think I did right.
Well, I'm not going to show my nipples, but the message was good.
Thank you.
But
Maybe after the show.
I do have a question, though.
Yeah.
Like, did you have any reactions from... did you give any strength to people that dared to move out of their comfort zone because of your performing?
Yeah, I heard that. And when I'm giving workshops, people are experiencing drag or being different for the first time, or when I give workshop theater classes. And after that, I heard people said, oh yeah, I started doing drag, or I start finally sewing or singing, and it felt so free. So yeah, I hope to inspire people that way to be themselves. They don't all have to be drag queens. I mean, I still need to have a job, so don't do that. But be you and do what you love the most. I think that's the most important.
Well, thank you for inspiring everyone.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for coming, Emily.
Yeah.
All right, put your hands together for Emily Salvia.
Thank you.
And our next speaker for today is a student from this place we are at, the TU Eindhoven, and I would like you all to put a warm welcome up for Ewout Hulsje.
This is Antarctica. This beautiful, magical landscape is Antarctica. A few weeks ago, I was talking with the Antarctic polar explorer, and she told me the first time she came here, she fell in love by the beauty of it, the absolute massive scale of Antarctica. And she became so in love that she actually moved her job here. And who wouldn't if you see these kinds of amazing, amazing pictures? And this is not only on the water side. This you can't only see from the water. Also inland, Antarctica has a lot of beauty. And maybe not because it's so big or a lot of mountains, but because of the emptiness. And the emptiness you most of the time only see in deserts. And Antarctica is also actually one big desert. Only then it's a big desert of ice. And this is very strange and very weird actually, because Antarctica is completely untouched. There are several people coming there, but except for that, it's completely untouched, and it's so vast and so massive. This goes on for thousands and thousands of kilometers. And when they say thousands of thousands, I really mean thousands of thousands, because Antarctica is not small. Antarctica is 1.4 times the size of Europe. And this whole continent is covered by multiple thousands of meters of ice. So can you imagine this much ice and this much area which we didn't touch? How much information can be on this continent? For example, strange things happen here. If you remove the ice cap from Antarctica, then underneath there is running water. There are lakes. But it's minus 60 degrees there, and there are actually living bacteria there, which is for us mind-blowing. Like, we don't know how this is actually possible. Another interesting about Antarctica is when meteoroids hit it. So meteoroids anywhere else in the world, they don't preserve. They hit a certain landscape and then they deteriorate and they don't exist anymore. However, in Antarctica, because it's so cold, the meteoroids exist for very, very long time and they get preserved very well. So Antarctica can tell us a lot. Antarctica can tell us about our past. Antarctica can tell us about our present. And it can be a meaning of our future. So how are we now obtaining that information from Antarctica? At the moment, research is done via vehicles like this. They are six wheels, big Toyota trucks, and they run on fossil fuels. So with that, they are limited in range. They can't go everywhere on Antarctica because they need fuel for the vehicle, but also fuel for the people who drive the vehicle. And how does the fuel actually go to Antarctica? The fuel on Antarctica goes via these planes. And yeah, they look pretty cool with the rockets on the side, but it's a really inefficient way of transporting fuel to Antarctica to then put it in a vehicle, which is then limited by the fuel you put so much effort into transporting to Antarctica in the first place. So what is actually inherently the problem here? And we think the problem is that there's no alternative. There is no other vehicle that can drive on Antarctica. There's no other way of transporting the fuel besides ship and plane. There's nothing else. So, okay, I told you a bit about Antarctica, but who am I in this whole story? What am I doing? So I'm a student of the TUE, and I'm part of a student team. And the core idea of every student team is to bring an alternative to a problem or a market, like here, with a solar team, with an electric bike. So I joined student team Polar. And Team Polar aims to venture into the unexplored territories of the Antarctica. And it aims to do this by a sustainable, autonomous vehicle. But what do I exactly mean with sustainable, and how far do we want to put that on our vehicles? So with sustainable, I mean making our energy from solar and wind. So this means that our vehicle can make its own energy. And because this makes its own energy, it's not limited by the fuel anymore. It can go anywhere on Antarctica and does not have to come back in order to refuel. So this is a complete change in infrastructure than what was before. The other thing that we want to do is make it sustainable. So what exactly does sustainable mean? Sustainable means there's no direct involvement of a human on the vehicle. So again, the vehicle doesn't have to return for fuel for the people or for a safe place or for a tent, nothing. So then again, it's limitless. So our team took on the challenge to design a Mars rover on Antarctica. To give you a bit context, Mars Rover is developed by NASA and it drives sustainably, autonomously, and it does research. So this is something that we want to put on Antarctica. And why do we want to do that, besides bringing an alternative? We aim to do this to create more knowledge. Like I said, create more knowledge about our past, our present, and our future. And we want to share this knowledge with as much people as possible, with all the people involved on Antarctica, but also all the people involved in general. The second thing is that we want to address the environmental impact we have on Antarctica. So maybe directly we are not touching Antarctica, but indirectly we have a massive impact on Antarctica. Like, these kinds of things break off almost daily. And this is something that we want to give address to. So like I said, this is a major, major, major challenge. And not too long ago I read, alone you can be smart, but together you are actually brilliant. So we as a group of 15 or 20 students, we are not going to make this vehicle by ourselves. We need expertise, we need funding, we need knowledge, we need a network, we need as much people as we can in order to make this happen. So, are you motivated? Are you interested? Or do you just want to work on this with this goal? And are you intrigued? Then please follow us on LinkedIn or drop me a mail at ewout.hulscher@teampolar.nl and hopefully we can get in touch soon.
Thank you, Ewout.
No problem.
Really interesting story as well. I can see there are a lot of similarities with space exploration or like planet discovery and so on. But before I ask any questions, let's move to the comments section.
Yes. Well, there are no comments for Ewout from the audience online.
All right. Well, it seems like you were pretty thorough with the whole story. So
yes.
How are the collaborations going with companies such as NASA and others? Are there any collaborations or?
Yeah, but NASA is still quite far away, but we have made the first contact with the European Space Agency, so ESA, and they told us already that our vehicle can really help their satellites with obtaining information from Antarctica. So it's not only working together with research stations on Antarctica, but you can also take it further to collaborate with space agencies to really bring more knowledge with their satellites to the world and to link up with them. So there's a bigger chance for us and a bigger market to jump in.
That's great. Thank you so much for coming, Ewout.
No problem. Thank you for the invitation.
Yes. Well, put your hands together for Ewout Hulscher.
Thank you.
Our next speaker for today is a comic artist and also a product designer. And sorry, I see some gestures. Really?
Yes.
Oh my God. Well, I'm certainly not a robot or an AI. I'm very human. And I make mistakes, okay? So, let me go through my cards. I can guarantee I didn't drink before this performance. So, like I was saying, our next speaker for today is all about bringing joy to the world as well on a weekly basis. I would like to welcome, I hope I spell your name correctly, Pearl Myung-hyo?
Almost.
All right. Well, she listens, so here she is.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Pearl Myung-hyo. I'm 29. I'm African. I'm from the Congo. I'm very proud of my roots and heritage, and it shows in everything that I do. I live here in Holland, in Eindhoven, with my son, Kimani. And today I want to tell you something about my platform that I just started with my group of girls. As you can see on this first picture, that is me, surrounded by 3-4 men harassing me, calling me names, go back to your own country, fuck you, you don't belong here, this is not your country. There was at a demonstration in Eindhoven in 2018. I stood there with my fist up in the air to protect myself. As you can see, we were protesting against Black Pete, who is very racist. A lot of black people, people of color in Holland, doesn't like the Dutch tradition, and we try to erase the blackness of the Piet. And a lot of people in Eindhoven disagreed in 2018, and they decided to show up to the city and to let their voices be heard by throwing eggs, throwing racist slurs, intimidating me, violating me as a woman, as a mother, and as a citizen of this city. That was the day that Vice.com showed these images and made us go viral. My video went around Holland and around the world with millions and millions and millions of views. That's why I want to tell to Eindhoven, please join us. Join us against racism. Join us in against our battle against injustice. Because what happened to me in 2018 happens to a lot of people of color, children of color, in Eindhoven. On this, that was the day that I decided to be an activist and to be more socially involved. I started showing up at protests, manifestations. I hosted BLM Den Bosch. I hosted BLM Eindhoven. I stood there in Venlo and in Limburg to stand up against the racial Black Pete and the traditions. Through activism, it got me together with an amazing group of females. As you can see, we were here eating, as always. But it was our first brainstorm meeting for the platform that I'm trying to introduce you to you guys today. Angel Filter. During my journey in activism, I made new friends, new sisters, and we decided to come together as one and to unite and to create this platform named Eindhoven No Filter. It's a platform by and for people from Eindhoven and outside the city. We want to involve, learn, and grow together and with you guys. We want to show people another mindset, an intersectional mindset, and a more open mind for the culture, for different people from different genders, religions, and races. We are 6 women, with each our own professions, and together with you, we want to have fun, give space to relevant, unheard voices in society, and upcoming talent in Eindhoven. In October, we launched our first first live show. I had several artists participate. I had a spoken word artist. I had a DJ. We made use of PondPay in Eindhoven. We had a professional creative team who helped us establish to showcase this live show through your homes and through your internet devices. Our first event was just in Plan P, as I told you. Nova Studios supported us, helped us through it, so it could be a very lovely night for you in your living room. On Eindhoven on platform, we discussed music, we discussed urban culture, we discussed African awareness, we discussed one-sided media, and from then on, we went to the radio. Every month, you can find us the first week of the month on Rara Radio. It's a local radio in Eindhoven. And every Wednesday and every Sunday of that week, you can listen to us. We talk about things that happen in life, music, artists, developments in the city, and much more. This past Sunday, I had a radio show. I had some guests. We talked about self-care and resilience. And we enjoyed some good music, good vibes, good food. I promoted locals with their businesses. I promoted local artists with their businesses. It was very chill, relaxing, a place where you could be safe to express yourself, to share your knowledge, to share your experiences, And that's what we want to do. We want to be a platform and create an environment where people feel safe to tell their stories and to have a voice. These past couple of months have been a roller coaster. I mean, it's been crazy. We had a lot of offers, a lot of opportunities coming our ways, and we are very thankful in every way. In the future, we would like to have more guests and more nice tunes and music and presentations to show you guys and the rest of Eindhoven and the world. Our aim is to manifest more inclusive and intersectional way of thinking in our city and in our society here in the Netherlands, for all genders and all people, for all cultures, religions, and race. We want people to have a safe place where they can showcase their talent and their voices. This is our platform. Eindje, no filter. It means zero filter. It means no fucks were given. It means I will say whatever the fuck I want to say. It means real news from real people in real circumstances and in real life. Making mistakes, learning and growing is our purpose, but evolving as we go. We would like to invite you to join us on this journey. I don't know if you're ready, but I know we are. So this is us, and also you, if you want to tell us your story. Let's create and evolve together. If this seems something for you, don't feel afraid to slide in our DMs. Link us up, and who knows, maybe soon, we will see you back at Eindje No Filter. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Perle.
Yeah.
I'm saying it right now.
Perle, okay? Yeah.
My apologies.
Not a problem.
It sounds way better like that. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Before we continue, like always, I'm really curious about the online community.
Yes, someone was wondering what the name of the platform was. So
Eindje No Filter. It actually means Eindje. It stands for Eindhoven. And the nul is for the zero, because there is no filter. And yeah, filter, it speaks for itself.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so that were the questions. I myself have a question, though. It's really local. It's for Eindhoven, you said?
It's for the people in and from Eindhoven. And of course, sometimes you try to find other locals or other peoples in the Netherlands to showcase their talents or their services.
That's really nice.
But the aim is really our city first, and show and broadcasting and showcasing the talents that we have here in this city.
So do you also have aspirations to go to Den Bosch or other cities like in the future?
Well, the plan is that people come to us. So we want to bring everybody to our city and show us what we are made of and what we are capable of. So of course we are always open to invite people from different cities and different areas from the Netherlands to share their experiences with us, or their talents, or their businesses, or anything in that form.
Wow, nice. Thank you.
Thank you too. Thank you.
Thank you, Perle. Perle from Eindje No Filter. And I do have my cards right this time, because I tipje van de sluier. I don't know the English way to say that, but our next speaker for today is a comic artist and a product designer that likes to capture stories of the very mundane. Please put your hands together for Bui Wang.
We all dream, and we know what's dreamlike. Sometimes we talk about it with our friends. But can you imagine a dream? What does it look like if you are born blind? And what if you think about the sound? Have you ever think about the color of the sound? And when there's a perception into our way of sensing And there's something that really can shift in our values. And now we are keeping safe distance with the people around us. Can you imagine what is 1.5 meter really exactly like when you talk or when you communicate with someone that you truly love? Because this perception really changed our way of seeing and sensing. And now I'm going to talk about perceptional design. My name is Bowie Wang. I'm a product designer. What I do is I hack daily product to challenge our perception. By using this perceptional design, I'm trying to make a solution for it. In the kitchen is the place that we use them every day and often. And imagine, if you can't see, but you want to cook a meal for you, for yourself, that you are starving. But how can you start? For example, how you cut or how you keep the food inside of your cutting board, these are something extremely challenging for the people who don't have a vision or low vision. What I do is I design a series of products that's oriented by the sense of touch, but not by vision. So it consists of four objects: a cutting board, a knife, a measuring cup, and a pen lid. When they cut things, you have to really, really have a very good control of how you cut, and they pretend to use small knife. So this knife is a rather very, very short handle to fit in your hand. And when you cut after the cutting, how can you know that everything is kept inside of your cutting board but not falling over everywhere? So this cutting board is designed with a groove that the food can be collected easily, and there's a space that you can slide the knife below it to protect your finger from hurting. And how do you know that how much liquid that you put in your cup that is enough for make a nice coffee? So they do is that they put finger inside of the cup to measure. So what I do, design a cup that with a holes that you blocked by your fingers. The liquid touch your finger and you know how much water is inside. And it's also risky that to use stoves, and because the normal pen lid are made of either glass or stainless steel, it's extremely dangerous when you want to locate the hot pen when you bite your fingers. So I made a wooden pen lid. And this is a designer I'm working with. His name is Simon Doher. We developed this project, and also we are going to work on a term called haptic aesthetic. And we are really, by designing from a non-visual perspective, we're challenging our perception of design. And if we think about perception, it can be both physical, emotional, and also sometimes rational. Because we learn the knowledge, and we know how to do a sort of things. We communicate through languages. The perception somehow is also been shaped and been delivered rationally. And we humans are so dominant in this world with a master of tools. And our tools are easy to communicate, to talk, to be accurate, and the measurement is the key of this system. And our tools are so powerful that it becomes the extension of our body. We shape the world. And on the other hand, it's also shaped our perception. For example, how we see the flat Earth is because we see it, and also the tools help us of seeing it. So in this pandemic, a lot of things changed, and we adopt to a new way of living. But somehow, our tools and our measuring systems are still keeping the same, although sometimes we feel different, for example, of the safe distance when we stand with someone we love. So what I do is I hack the series of very basic measuring tools, make them elastic or interactive. For example, this ruler, it's not only straight, but also elastic. It's made of rubber, silicone rubber, that it can change the scale by the tension that you add on the both sides of the ruler. And a drawing compass that can draw a perfect round circle, but the tip is the brush. So the marks varied during the drawing process. Basically, you can use your chi to draw a circle but with some variation. And also, they have another two objects. And this is a kind of like a reflective prism that can also measure 45 degrees, 30 degrees, 90 degrees, but it's rather a prism that can reflect and you can interact with it. And these tools somehow is for not only as a concept, but also it's a product, educational product for adults to relearn our perception and knowledge. And also it's for teenagers to understand the reason why we create these measurements and the reason behind. And it encourages some interpretation and your own personality. So changing perception somehow giving us a new way of seeing. And by seeing so, if we see a problem differently, and we might find something that we never seen before, and it might become a solution that helping us go out of this uncertainty. So yeah, that's my sharing for today. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Bowie.
Yes, thanks.
Let's move on to the comments section online.
Yes. So far there are no comments. It is a bit lagging behind the live stream. So if you have a comment, just type it in as fast as possible, and then I can see it.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
Well, I have a lot of questions, but I'm only allowed to maybe 9. No. Like with the times now with Corona. I'm really curious about your perspective with everything we touch now, with the bacterial of with the virus going around.
Yeah.
Do you have any? Are you working on things like that as well?
Yes, and no, because for the haptics, it's if you see the people who don't have the sense, it's really about. This is the one of the priority that they can touch. So on the other hand, this situation, like the question you ask, it's also created a huge barrier for them to communicate. And this also something that in my concern of, you know, the new situation or the new rules that we made, is that really like inclusive enough for the people, for example, for people who read Braille's in the train station when they goes down, you know, the Braille's on the handrail.
Yes.
And these things, really small details, are not been considered that much yet. And it also shows this perception of policy making. And that's also, I see the potential of my design approaches is to provoke this attention and idea when we really think about inclusiveness, especially in a very special situation like now. Are we considerate enough for the real good well-being for everyone? Yeah.
Well, it's a lot to think of in the future, but you're doing really interesting experiments and concepts. And thank you for inspiring all of us. I can clearly see you're really passionate about what you're doing. So
yeah.
Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah,
with
thanks
us.
For inviting me.
Sorry, there are some questions from
Great.
Online. Is it okay to ask them?
Yes,
right
please.
Now? Yeah, so Rachel is wondering if you can share something about the flatness perspective in life.
Yeah, now it's like we are very stuck in this situation. Sometimes we adopt our way of being, but emotionally we feel sometimes awkward or insecure of a situation like when we greeting or when we talk. But sometimes, if you have a flexible attitude or something, or these things being put in the, as an educational course or even as a like a tutoring or mentoring for the people who feel very insecure about it, has a curing function, and to really like positively give more care to the people empathetically. And yeah, that's the thing I see the potential of this, yeah, inclusiveness in a bigger sense. Yeah.
Okay, nice. Yeah, I think Rachel will be happy with that answer.
Thanks.
There's one other question from Ilgaz. And it's a kind of a technical question, I think. How does the elastic ruler work? How can you differentiate the tension of the rubber?
Yeah, basically, it's for example, you can hold it on both sides. You just it's like you are stretching a rubber band, but the marks changing the scale. For example, when this is 1 centimeter, by stretching it, you might extend it to 10 centimeter. So this scale of 1 centimeter somehow changed. It's an interpretation of, you know, the tension that you added on it. It can be a physical tension or any tension that you can imagine above.
I would really like to see the real thing anytime soon.
Yes.
Thank you so much for coming. Bowie Wang, everybody.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks.
And that concludes our 38th edition of Petra Kucha Eindhoven from, but we're still very much alive. Thanks for keeping us all alive. And we're almost done with this horrible year, but we learned a lot and it opened new perspectives. So our next edition, the 39th edition of Petra Kucha, will be on the 18th of March in 2021, the most promising year of this century. But remember, we need people that are passionate like Bowie is, because if you have something you're passionate about, something that might seem very normal to you, you can you can infect other people's with that, and they might follow in your footsteps, and they can dare and try to be themselves. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Gijs Habrake, but you can call me Gus in English if you like. Thank you so much for coming. See you guys on the 18th of March. Bye.